Hang the DJ, a romantic comedy embedded in technology. The relationships within are fairly traditional. Boy meets girl, they hook up, they argue, they separate, they reconcile at the end. But plot twist, it was all a simulation. I recently watched the first two seasons of Peaky Blinders, and then watching through this again, I was expecting Joe Cole to just smash Lenny's face at any moment for nabbing his bird. Even with the awkwardly flirtatious tone, it wouldn't be Black Mirror if it didn't have technology somehow in control over the entire situation. The system, or coach in app form, is a form of technology that guides individuals to finding their perfect match. It goes beyond mere guidance, however, as we see people adapting to their reality under its omniscient guidance, causing them to behave like cult followers. There is undoubtedly a critique of dating apps, something I've never personally signed up for, but takes the idea and advances it so that it doesn't really calculate how long your relationship will last, but more how long you must stay with that person. The mechanics of this universe are quite astounding to just conceptualize alone, which is something we'll be exploring with reference to simulation theory and religion. So, without further ado, let's explore the regulations and abilities that produce a convincing reality for our simulants. The episode was filmed in Painshill Park, an 18th century landscape garden in the UK. Now, interestingly, landscape gardens became popular across Europe in that time, replacing the more formal and symmetrical designs primarily influenced by the French. What's most interesting is that the French designs impose order on nature, whereas landscape gardens like Painshill Park present an ideal view of nature instead. Intriguingly, we see several shots that involve symmetry in its background also. Some shots are very strict in this manner, which are done to give two impressions. One, to reinforce how controlled these people's lives are by the system, and two, to show the unnatural level of control over something that we humans have been doing naturally for thousands and thousands of years. Frank and Amy's nerves are combined with the pressure of the omnipresence of the system. We see this when the pair are unsure if they're allowed to try each other's food, something so simple and endearing that can be considered taboo behavior in this world. The idea of a relationship having an expiry date is very uncomfortable, but a sad truth nonetheless. This perhaps unnecessary piece of information prevents freedom between the couple choosing who they want to date and how long for. Despite the attraction Frank and Amy have for one another, their date is short and controlled. The fact that the system has given them limited time and has selected their food for them forces them to eat the food quickly and cuts away any natural discussion about the menu. When the pair arrive at their temporary home, if you like, they ask their coaches for advice on sex, which is used to an amusing effect, as I'm sure any human on the internet would be able to provide them with an answer. Don't ever trust WikiHow, kids. Unlike the machine that doesn't quite understand human euphemisms like go at it. Amy and Frank then talk about how difficult those without the machine would find it to do the whole relationship thing, warning of how dependent people may become should apps like Tinder advance to this degree. The fact they both have to make a decision as to how the rest of the night is going to play out terrifies them. Yet the moment the pair stop talking and start doing, it's made really quite dramatic because of how odd of an experience this must be for these people who have only just been brought into existence. The camera focuses on her lips, closes in on their hands. The sensations they're experiencing here must be the first they've ever felt. We then see a contrasting montage of Frank and Amy, shall we politely say, dating other people. Frank doesn't even put in the effort to arrive on time to his first date, and from there, their relationship is so bad that the moment they separate is just relief, all for the sake of machine learning. Frank has so much faith in the system, he says that the year-long relationship will happen for a reason, even continuing to smile despite how he and his partner are framed. Whilst Frank was enduring a year of boredom and disappointment, Amy experiences amazing sex in a physical but not emotional relationship. Despite how amazing and frequent the sex is between Amy and Lenny, she still longs for the intimacy and excitement of her first date, shown when she places her hand in Lenny's in the hopes of reliving that moment. The machine tests her again when she cures one irritation Lenny possesses and another comes on immediately afterwards when he picks his ear. What makes it more straining for the viewer is when he exhales even after finally being asked not to. When Amy and Lenny's relationship ends, they say it's a shame it has to end, but the moment they get to be apart from one another, it changes to thank God for that. After Frank's bad relationship ends, the system explains that you have to go through a few bad ones to get the right one, indicating that the system system is testing the pair to the limits of their patience, and whether they would be so quick to forget each other after their first date. Even when Frank and Amy bump into each other at the wedding, they still share an obvious connection despite the fact they are bound to other people. The system plays on a human instinct, namely faith, to keep all the simulants in line and running without issue. The simulants are constantly given hope with the statistic of 99.8% thrown at them all the time, and all the events, be they in a restaurant or at a wedding, are attended as a congregation. This ritualistic way of conducting activities allows for a greater desire for our protagonists to break the system. This is seen when Frank eats garlic dip despite his protesting girlfriend. The pair are so strong-willed in their feelings towards each other, unlike the other simulants seem to be, who are content and unchallenging of the narrative of the system. When Frank and Amy end up on another date, they choose not to check the expiry date, showing that they would rather live without the oppressive technological institution that governs their lives. This also brings forth an element of trust, which is what makes their relationship so successful. They don't need to worry about any of the problems they have with each other, as there's no time limit. Of course, there is a time limit to every relationship in life, but it's about making the most of the time you have with somebody who is most faithful to you. However, when Frank gives into temptation and checks the expiry date, it's like the system is almost punishing him for breaking his promise to Amy, as well as breaking the rules and checking the expiry date without her. Frank therefore has more faith in the system than he does in Amy. When making up his mind about it, he's divided mentally by the lighting of this shot. Even though he got what he wanted, the ticking urge to be updated with information runs rampant in a techno-social society. When the pair argue about the expiry date, the mention of escaping immediately attracts the eyes of onlookers. Even the security guard reappears with a taser. This hive mind mentality perhaps makes you realize you're not dealing with individuals anymore, just products of the system. This is why they look pretty unnerving to the audience and reveals more evidence of a simulation too. When learning that Frank had checked the expiry date behind her back, Amy is shown in the darkest, bluest shot you could possibly imagine, with heartbreak and betrayal tumbling down on top of her. As she watches all the various partners that accompany her to bed every night, the light of the room glows bluer and bluer, portraying her loneliness and depression, despite all the human attention she is forced to receive after her breakup with Frank. The ending of this episode proves, as always, to be distinctly bittersweet. The simulated versions of Frank and Amy were released from their imprisonment so that a real dating app could calculate the success of a real couple's relationship before they'd even met. Either way, it did pique my interest a bit with regards to simulation theory, which is something I probably should have talked about in my playtest video, but I'm gonna touch on it now instead. The argument of whether we humans are in some cruel simulation in reality seems to spur the imagination, so it's no surprise Brooker likes to use it in Black Mirror. When I think of being in a simulation, my brain creates an image of a giant alien creature operating me like a sim from his own high-tech computer for his own amusement. Perhaps Black Mirror is suggesting that an entire simulated universe being created is more likely to be used for the purposes of fine-tuning behavior. If there was a simulation to be created of you, it would have to be for a particular reason, but like reality, it has to appear on some level that the simulation is running without one.
We only need enough universe to fool the inhabitants of our simulation into thinking that they're real.
Now, based on the idea that simulations have utility, and that at some point in the future we have computers powerful enough to create these ultra-realistic simulations, then it doesn't seem improbable to believe that we are all in fact inside a simulation. Elon Musk and Neil deGrasse Tyson have both pitched into the debate with similar ideas, but I find it most intriguing because we have no way of identifying whether we inhabit a simulation physically. It's like religion, you believe it or you don't. I would not doubt that a machine that can simulate realities would be of a benefit to science, and undoubtedly artificial intelligence would find simulations extremely useful if it intends on improving human life instead of destroying it entirely. Back to reality, the song heard playing at the end of the story is Panic by The Smiths. The inspiration for this song was from a radio announcement of the Chernobyl disaster, which was immediately followed by the DJ switching over straight afterwards to the song I'm Your Man by Wham. The lyrics also talk about how the pop music heard on the radio, quote, says nothing about my life and that music fans will, quote, burn down the disco and hang the DJ in their outrage against how seemingly unperturbed the radio station was by the disaster. The song is also about a desire to rebel, a common theme shown throughout the episode, and wanting to rebel against a constant, fixed system similar to the system that Frank and Amy experienced inside the simulation. Thanks for watching. Are we living in a simulation? Am I real? Does anything I do matter? Get wrecked in the comments, where we will continue this discussion.